Welcome to the Contending for the Word podcast, a podcast devoted to helping inform, educate, equip, and warn people about false teachers, false movements, and unbiblical philosophies. Now join our host for today's episode and enjoy.
All right, everybody, welcome back to the Contending for the Word podcast. My name is Dave, and I'm the host for this show. And on today's episode, we're going to talk about something that is really, really important this Reformation week, and that is why the Reformation still matters over and against what the Catholic Church teaches. Now, the Protestant Reformation was a 16th century movement fueled by the concern of faithful pastor theologians like Martin Luther and many men before him that the church be grounded in the Word of God. So Martin Luther confronted the teaching of indulgences because he was concerned about the souls of men and made known the truth of the finished and sufficient work of the Lord Jesus no matter the cost. Men like John Calvin preached multiple times a week from the Word of God and engaged in personal correspondence with pastors the world over. With Luther in Germany, Ulrich Zwingli in Switzerland, and John Calvin in Geneva, the Reformation spread worldwide. Now, even before these men were around, there were men like Peter Walden in 1140 to 1217 AD and his followers in the Alpine regions, John Wycliffe and the Lollards in England, and John Huss and his followers in Bohemia were laboring for the Reformation. So one of the most significant figures in the Reformation was Martin Luther. And in many ways, Martin Luther, with his towering intellect and over-the-top personality, helped ignite the Reformation and fueled it into a bonfire under his watch. His nailing of the 95 Theses to the church door in Wittenberg on October 31st, 1517, provoked a debate that led to his being excommunicated by a papal bull from the Roman Catholic Church. Luther's study of the Word of God led to the confrontation at the Diet of Worms with the Catholic Church. Now, at the Diet of Worms, he famously said that unless he could be persuaded by plain reason and by the Word of God, he would not budge and would stand on the Word of God because he could do no other. Luther's study of Scripture led him to oppose the church in Rome on many fronts, including focusing on Scripture over church tradition and what the Bible teaches about how sinners can be made righteous in the sight of the Lord Jesus by the finished and sufficient work of Christ alone. Luther's rediscovery of justification by faith alone in Christ alone and his translation of the Bible into German enabled people in his time to study the Word of God. Another critical aspect of Luther's ministry was recapturing the biblical view of the believer's priesthood, showing that all people and their work have purpose and dignity because they serve the Creator God. Others followed Luther's brave example, including the following: Hugh Latmyer, Martin Bucer, William Tyndale, Philip Melanchthon, John Rogers, and Henrik Bullinger. All of these and many others were committed to Scripture and to the sovereign grace of God. In 1543, another prominent figure in the Reformation, Martin Bucer, asked John Calvin to write a defense of the Reformation to Emperor Charles V at the Imperial Diet to meet at Speyer in 1544. Bucer knew that Charles V was surrounded by counselors who opposed reform in the church and believed that Calvin was the most capable defender of the Reformation, had to defend the Protestants. Calvin rose to the challenge by writing the brilliant work, The Necessity of Reforming the Church. And while Calvin's argument did not convince Charles V, the necessity of reforming the church has come to be regarded as the best presentation of Reformed Protestantism ever written. Another critical person in the Reformation of the church was Johannes Gutenberg, who invented the printing press in 1454. The printing press enabled the reformers' ideas to spread rapidly, bringing renewal in the Word of God and all Scripture taught to the church. Now, the distinguishing mark of the Protestant Reformation are in the five slogans known: sola Scripture or Scripture alone, solus Christus or Christ alone, sola gratia, grace alone, sola fide, faith alone, and sola Deo Gloria, to the glory of God alone. Now, one of the main reasons the Protestant Reformation occurred was the abuse of spiritual authority. The central issue of the Reformation was the authority of the Lord and His Word. The church's most critical authority is the Lord and His written revelation. If anybody wants to hear God speak, they must read the Word of God. And if they're going to hear Him audibly, then they must read the Word out loud. When the Reformers proclaimed Scripture alone, they expressed a commitment to the authority of Scripture as a reliable, sufficient, binding, clear, and trustworthy Word of God. The Reformation was a crisis over which authority should have priority, the church or Scripture. Protestants are not against church history, which helps Christians understand their faith's roots. Instead, what Christians mean by sola scriptura, or Scripture alone, is that we are first and foremost committed to the Word of God and all it teaches, because we are convinced it is the reliable, sufficient, binding, clear, and trustworthy Word of God. So with Scripture as our foundation, Christians can learn from the church fathers as Calvin and Luther did, but Protestants do not place the church fathers or church tradition above the Word of God. So at stake in the Reformation was a central issue of who is authoritative: the Pope, the church's traditions or church councils, personal feelings, or Scripture alone. Well, Rome claimed the church's authority lay with Scripture and tradition at the same level. So this made Scripture and the Pope at the same level as Scripture and church councils. The Protestant Reformation sought to change these convictions by placing authority with the Word of God alone. Now, a commitment to Scripture alone leads to a rediscovery of the doctrines of grace, because any return to Scripture leads to the teaching of God's sovereignty in His sovereign grace. See, the church today is always in need of reformation around the Word of God. Even in the New Testament, Bible readers discover Jesus rebuking Peter and Paul correcting the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians, since we are, as Martin Luther said, at the same time both saints and sinners, simul justus el pictor, to be clear, and the church is full of people. The church is always in need of reformation around the Word of God. Now, undergirding the five souls is a Latin phrase, Ecclesia Semper Reformanda Est, which means the church is always to be reforming. The Word of God stands individually and collectively over the people of God. The church must not only preach the Word of God, but always be listening to the Word of God. Romans 10:17 says, faith comes by hearing, and hearing through the Word of Christ. The church during the Reformation, like today, needs reformation, but it should always be reforming itself around the Word of God. The Reformers came to the conclusions they did not only through the study of the church fathers, which they had extensive knowledge of, but by studying God's Word. Dr. Michael Horton is right as he explains the need not only to hear the Word individually as people, but collectively as a whole when he says this. Personally and corporately, the church comes into being and is kept alive by hearing the gospel. The church is always on the receiving end of God's good gifts and His correction. The Spirit does not lead us apart from the Word of God, but directs us back to Christ as He's revealed in Scripture. We always need to return to the voice of our shepherd. The same gospel that creates the church sustains and renews it. Now, Ecclesia Semper Reformanda Est, rather than being restrictive, it provides a foundation for the five stools to stand upon. The church exists because of Christ, is in Christ, and is for the spread of the glory of Christ. As Dr. Michael Horton further explains, we evoke the whole phrase, the church reformed and always being reformed according to the Word of God. We confess that we belong to the church and not simply to ourselves, and that this church is always created and renewed by the Word of God rather than by the spirit of the age. So here are four things to know about the Protestant Reformation. The Protestant Reformation is a renewal movement to reform the church to the Word of God. The Protestant Reformation is sought to restore Scripture to the church and the primary place of the gospel in the local church's life. The Reformation involved a rediscovery of the Holy Spirit. John Calvin, for example, was known as a theologian of the Holy Spirit. For the Reformation makes the people of God small and the person and work of the Lord Jesus big. Augustine once said that describing the Christian life is one of humility, 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 and John Calvin echoed that sentiment. The five souls are not unimportant to the church's life and health, but instead provide robust and genuinely evangelical faith and practice. So on this Thursday, October 31st, 2024, Protestants celebrate the work of the Lord in the life and ministry of the Reformers. May you be stirred by the example of the men and women who have gone before you. These were men and women who loved the Word of God, who loved the people of God, and who longed to see renewal in the church for the glory of God. May their example encourage Christians today to proclaim the glory of the grace of God to all people, all for His glory. So throughout this episode, we're going to hear a variety of perspectives from sound, trustworthy scholars. Our first one is Dr. Stephen Nichols. He's a teaching fellow with Ligonier Ministries. He's a friend of the ministry, and also he's an incredible scholar of church history. I recommend you pick up his books. Well, today he's going to answer the question, how can we uphold sola scriptura as well as Christian history? So let's hear from Dr. Nichols now.
This is a really crucial question, and to grasp this, let's go back to the Reformation itself, where sola scriptura was born. The issue here was authority. That's what sola scriptura was about. And what you found in the Catholic Church, that authority was actually answered with two masters. We have the biblical text, but we also have tradition. And in fact, what was happening was the biblical text was being read through tradition and being understood through tradition. So in reality, the tradition of the church was the authority of the church. And when Luther realized that, he realized that is really the fundamental principle. And because of that, the gospel, this central and essential teaching of the Bible, was eclipsed. So they go hand in hand, sola scriptura and sola fide. Because when we get back to the church and we strip away all those additions and all those layers of authority and we go back to the text, there we see the pure and simple gospel. But it was a question of tradition and a question of authority. Now, Luther was very quickly accused of dismissing 1,500 years of church history when he did that. So Luther himself says, no, no, that is not what's happening in sola scriptura. He wrote a very important text called On the Councils and the Church. And he said, while scripture is our authority, scripture alone is our authority, we do not dismiss the councils and the church. In fact, they are very helpful for us to understand scripture and how to be disciples, faithful disciples of Jesus Christ. And then Luther just simply says this. In fact, we have in the Bible itself the office of teacher. God has given to His church the office of teacher to assist His church in understanding His word and how to live it in their lives. And so sometimes we as Protestants, under the banner of sola scriptura, simply dismiss tradition. And we sort of go the other extreme. The Reformers did not do that. They held so white-knuckled to the sole authority of God's word, but they were able to recognize the true value and the true role and the true place that church history played in the life of the church today. And we need to capture that back. We need not to commit the error of Rome, but neither do we need to go in the other direction and simply write off church history. The Reformers themselves didn't do that, and we shouldn't do that either as we uphold sola scriptura.
You know, today we live in a world filled with competing truth claims. Every day we are bombarded with declarations that something is true and that something else is false. We are told what to believe and what not to believe. We are asked to behave one way but not another way. In her monthly column, What I Know For Sure, Oprah Winfrey tells us how to handle our lives and our relationships. The New York Times editorial page regularly tells us what approach we should take to the big moral, legal, or public policy issues of the day. Richard Dawkins, the British atheist and evolutionist, he tells us how to think of our historical origins and our place in this universe. How do we sift through all these claims? How do we know what to think about our relationships, morality, God, the origin of the universe, and many other important questions? Well, to answer such questions, people need some sort of norm, standarding, or criteria to which they can appeal. In other words, we need an ultimate authority. Of course, everyone has some sort of ultimate norm to which they appeal, whether or not they are aware of what their norm happens to be. Some people appeal to reason and logic to adjudicate competing truth claims. Others appeal to sense experience. Still others refer to themselves and their own subjective sense of things. And although there is some truth in each of these approaches, Christians have historically rejected all of them as the ultimate standard for knowledge. Instead, God's people have universally affirmed that there is only one thing that can legitimately function as a supreme standard, God's word. There can be no higher authority than God himself. Of course, we are not the first generation of people to face the challenge of competing truth claims. In fact, Adam and Eve faced such a dilemma at the very beginning. God had clearly said to them in Genesis 2:17, "You shall surely die if you were to eat of the tree of the knowledge." On the other hand, the serpent said the opposite to them, "You will not surely die," in Genesis 3:4. How should Adam and Eve have adjudicated these competing claims? By empiricism? By rationalism? By what seemed right to them? No, there was only one standard to which they should have appealed to make this decision, the word of God that God had spoken to them. Unfortunately, this is not what happened. Instead of looking to God's revelation, Eve decided to investigate things further. Genesis 3:6 says, "When the woman saw that the tree was good for food and that this was a delight to the eyes, she took of its fruit and ate." Now make no mistake, the fall was not just a matter of Adam and Eve's eating the fruit. At its core, the fall was about God's people rejecting God's word as the ultimate standard for all of life. But if God's word is the ultimate standard of all of life, the next question is critical. Where do we go to get God's word? Where can it be found, we must ask. This issue, of course, brings us back to what Dr. Nichols was talking about in his remarks. It brings us to one of the core debates, of the Protestant Reformation. While the Roman Catholic Church authorities agreed that God's word was the ultimate standard for all of life and doctrine, they believed this word could be found in places outside of the word of God. Rome claimed a trifold authority structure, which included scripture, tradition, and the magisterium. The key component in this trifold authority was the magisterium itself, which is the authoritative teaching office of the Roman Catholic Church, manifested primarily in the Pope. Because the Pope was considered the successor of the Apostle Peter, his pronouncement is ex cathedra, were regarded as the very words of God himself. And it was at this very point that the Reformers stood their ground. While acknowledging that God had indeed delivered his word to his people in a variety of ways before Christ, as Hebrews 1:1 says, they argued that we should no longer expect ongoing revelation now that God has spoken finally and fully in his Son in Hebrews 1:2. Scripture is clear that the apostolic office was designed to perform a one-time redemptive historical task, that is to lay the foundation of the church according to Ephesians 2:20. The foundation laying activity of the apostles primarily consisted of giving the church a deposit of authoritative teaching, testifying to and applying the great redemptive work of Christ. Thus, the New Testament writings, which are the permanent embodiment of this apostolic teaching, should be seen as the final installment of God's revelation to his people. These writings, together with the Old Testament, are the only ones that are rightly considered the word of God. And so, by emphasizing the autonomy of the individual believer, one is left with only private, subjective conclusions about what Scripture means. It is not so much the authority of Scripture that is prized as the authority of the individual. The conviction of sola scriptura, that the Scriptures alone are the Word of God, and therefore the only infallible rule for life and doctrine, it provided the fuel needed to ignite the Reformation. Indeed, it was regarded as a formal cause of the Reformation, whereas sola fide, or faith alone, was regarded as the material cause. The sentiments of this doctrine are embodied in Martin Luther's famous speech at the Diet of Worms in 1521, after he was asked to recant their teachings, when he said, "Unless I am convinced by the testimony of Scripture or by clear reason, for I do not trust either in the Pope or in councils alone, since it is well known that they have often erred and contradicted themselves, I am bound by the Scriptures I have quoted, and my conscience is captive to the Word of God. I cannot and will not retract anything, since it is neither safe nor right to go against conscience. May God help me. Amen." For Luther, the scriptures and scripture alone were the final arbiter of what we should believe. Of course, like many core Christian convictions, the doctrine of sola scriptura has often been misunderstood and misapplied. Unfortunately, some have used sola scriptura as a justification for me, God, and the Bible type of individualism, where the church bears no real authority and the history of the church is not considered when interpreting and applying scripture. Thus, many churches today are almost ahistorical, cut off entirely from the rich tradition, creeds, and confessions of the church. They misunderstand sola scriptura to mean that the Bible is the only authority, rather than understanding it means that the Bible is the only infallible authority. Ironically, such an individualistic approach actually undercuts the very doctrine of sola scriptura it intends to protect. By emphasizing the autonomy of the individual believer, one is left with only private subjective conclusions about what scripture means. It is not so much the authority of scripture that is prized as the authority of the individual. The reformers would not have recognized such a distortion as their doctrine of sola scriptura. On the contrary, they were quite keen to rely on the church fathers, church councils, and the creeds and confessions of the church. Such historical rootedness was viewed not only as a means for maintaining orthodoxy, but also as a means for maintaining humility. Contrary to popular perceptions, the reformers did not view themselves as coming up with something new. Rather, they understood themselves to be recovering something very old, something that the church had originally believed, but later twisted and distorted. The reformers were not innovators, but were excavators. There are other extremes against which the doctrine of sola scriptura protects us today. While we certainly want to avoid the individualistic and ahistorical posture of many churches today, sola scriptura also protects us from overcorrecting and raising creeds and confessions or other human documents or ideas to the level of the Word of God. We must always be on guard against making the same mistakes as Rome and embracing what we might call traditionalism, which attempts to bind the consciences of Christians in areas that the Bible does not. In this sense, sola scriptura is a guardian of Christian liberty. But the biggest danger we face when it comes to sola scriptura is not misunderstanding it. The biggest danger is forgetting it. We are prone to think of this doctrine purely in terms of 16th century debates, just a vestige of the age-old Catholic-Protestant battles and irrelevant for the modern day. But the Protestant church in the modern day needs this doctrine now more than ever. The lessons that the Reformation gives have largely been forgotten, and the church once again has begun to rely on ultimate authorities outside of Scripture. And in order to lead the church back to sola scriptura, we must realize that we cannot do so only by teaching about the doctrine of self, but we must do that for sure. Instead, the primary way we lead the church back is actually by preaching the whole Word of God. Only the Word of God has the power to transform and reform our churches. And so we must not only talk about sola scriptura, but we must demonstrate sola scriptura. And when we do, we must preach all of the Word of God, not picking and choosing the parts that we prefer or thinking our congregations want to hear. We must preach only the Word, sola scriptura, and we must preach all the Word, tota scriptura. The two go hand in hand. When they are joined together in the power of the Holy Spirit, we can have hope for a new Reformation. Now let's hear from Pope Francis on what he says about people from his interview from 60 Minutes.
When you look at the world, what gives you hope?
Todo.
Everything.
Uno ve tragedia.
You see tragedies.
Pero ve.
But you also see so many beautiful
tantas
things.
Cosas lindas. Uno ve madres heroicas.
You see heroic mothers.
Hombres heroicos.
Heroic men. Men who have hopes and dreams, women who look to the future. That gives me a lot of hope.
La gente quiere vivir.
People want to live. People forge ahead. And people are fundamentally good. We are all fundamentally good. Yes, there are some rogues and sinners, but the heart itself is good.
Now, in contrast to what you just heard from Pope Francis, let's hear from Michael Reeves on the most common misunderstanding about the Reformation.
Perhaps the most common misconception about the Reformation is the idea that the Reformation was confronting moral abuses and corruptions of the time, and that's it. So simply things had got a bit grubby in Rome, and Luther and the reformers were fed up and wanted things to be done in a purer, more correct way. And that simply doesn't wash with what the Reformation was. And if you believe that, you will think the Reformation is something really to be consigned to history. But it doesn't work, for you see, just before the Reformation, thousands would flock in Florence to hear Savonarola and his sermons castigating the Pope for his immorality. And Pope Alexander VI was a profoundly immoral Pope. Everyone seemed to enjoy that. People laughed when Dante put two popes in the eighth circle of hell in his Inferno. That didn't seem to cause a ripple. Everyone thought, yes, there are priests who drink too much before Mass and there are corrupt old popes. But Luther and the reformers were not seeking to have the way things were done, done better. It was not, let's sort ourselves out and give the church a bit of a clean and a scrub. They were saying, no, the heart of God's message is we cannot sort ourselves out. What we need is a rescue. And so rather than telling the church we should purify ourselves, the reformers preached Christ as a savior who rescues those who cannot sort themselves out. And therein lies the difference between the misunderstanding of the Reformation and what the reformers were actually teaching. And there's a way that Luther put it in a very early disputation of his, right at the beginning of the Reformation. He said, sinners are loved not because they make themselves attractive. Sinners are attractive because they are loved. That is an entirely different message to a let's sort ourselves out. And that is precisely why the message of the Reformation, which in those words of Luther, sounds so contemporary. The message of the Reformation is entirely contemporary. Here's a message for those who think that by sorting themselves out, they can make themselves more attractive to God, to others. Here's a message that with God, it's the other way around. You're attractive because you're loved.
Now, I also want you to hear from Vodi Bakum, who is crystal clear in a message that he gave at the Shepherd's Conference a few years ago on what the gospel is.
When people say, no, our problem is this, our problem is that, we say, no, our problem is that God created the world, and God created man, and he put man in the garden to keep the garden, and he gave the man a command. And he held that man to perfect, perpetual obedience to that command. And he promised him life if he kept it and death if he didn't. And he didn't keep it. He ate. And because he ate, because of that one man, sin entered the world and death through sin. And everyone born from that man through ordinary generation inherited that man's sin nature. And because of that sin nature, sins proceed from it. And our world is broken because of that sin. And we stand guilty before a holy and righteous God. And we know that he's holy and we know that he's righteous and we crave justice. But the problem is that if God gives us justice, we all die. And so that God, in his goodness and in his mercy, sent forth his son, who was not born of ordinary generation, but was born of a virgin. Yes, the virgin birth matters. Why? Because if he's born of ordinary generation, he's born in sin. But because he's not born of ordinary generation, he's not born in sin. He's clean of sin. His record is clean. And he keeps his record clean. And he obeys God's law. And because he's fully God and fully man, He obeys the law of God on our behalf in his active obedience. And then in his passive obedience, God made him who knew no sin to be sin for us. All we like sheep had gone astray. Each of us had turned to his own way, but God laid upon him the iniquity of us all. And Christ died for sin once for all, the just for the unjust. And God imputes our sinfulness to him. And he nails our sinfulness to the tree. And Christ dies and raises again on the third day for our justification. And there's another imputation. The righteousness of Christ is actually imputed to us so that God can be both just and the justifier of the one who places faith in Jesus Christ, so that all those who come to Christ may enter in, so that all those who place faith in Christ might be saved, but not only saved, but sanctified, because he's the firstborn of many brethren. We're justified and we're adopted into the family of God, and we're sanctified, and as his children, we begin to bear the family resemblance, and we're further sanctified throughout this life by the very same gospel that saves us, until one day when it's all said and done, we're not just saved from the penalty of sin. We're not just saved from the power of sin, but one day we're glorified and saved from the very presence of sin. That's the gospel that we preach. That's the gospel that we need. And that's the gospel that's more than enough.
Now, the gospel of Jesus Christ is always at risk of distortion. It became distorted in the centuries leading up to the Protestant Reformation of the 16th century. It became distorted at innumerable other points of church history, and it is often distorted today. This is why Martin Luther said that the gospel must be defended in every generation. It is the center point of attack by the forces of evil. They know that if they can get rid of the gospel, they can get rid of Christianity. And there are two sides of the gospel: the good news of the New Testament, an objective side, and a subjective side. The objective content of the gospel is the person and work of Jesus, who he is, and what he accomplished in his life, death, a burial, and resurrection. The subjective side is a question of how the benefits of Christ's work are appropriated to the believer. There, the doctrine of justification comes to the fore. Many issues were involved in the Reformation, but the core matter, the material issue of the Reformation, was the gospel, especially the doctrine of justification. There was no great disagreement between the Roman Catholic Church authorities and the Protestant reformers about the subjective side. All the parties agreed that Jesus was divine, the Son of God and the Virgin Mary, and that he lived a perfect life of obedience, died on the cross in an atoning death, and was raised from the grave. The battle was over the second part of the gospel, the subjective side, the question of how the benefits of Christ are applied to believer. The reformers believed and taught that we are justified by faith alone. Faith, they said, is a sole instrumental cause for our justification. By this, they mean that we receive all the benefits of Jesus' work through putting our trust in the Lord alone. So we receive all the benefits of Jesus' work through putting our trust in Christ alone. The Roman Communion also taught that faith is a necessary condition for salvation. For example, at the seminal Church Council of Trent in 1545 through 1563, which formulated Rome's response to the Reformation, the Roman Catholic authorities declared that faith affords three things: the intuum, the fundamentum, and the radix. That is, faith is the beginning of justification, the foundation for justification, and the root of justification. But Rome also held that a person can have true faith and still not be justified, because there was much more to the Roman system. In reality, the Roman view of the gospel, as expressed at Trent, was that justification is accomplished through the sacraments. Initially, the recipient must accept and cooperate in baptism, by which he receives justifying grace. He retains that grace until he commits a mortal sin. Mortal sin is called mortal because it kills the grace of justification. The sinner then must be justified a second time. That happens through the sacrament of penance, which the Council of Trent defined as a second plank of justification for those who have made shipwreck of their souls. The fundamental difference was this. Trent said that God does not justify anyone until real righteousness inheres within the person. In other words, God does not declare a person righteous unless he or she is righteous. So according to Roman Catholic doctrine, justification depends on a person's sanctification. By contrast, the Reformers said justification is based on the imputation of the righteousness of Jesus Christ alone. The only ground by which a person can be saved is Jesus' righteousness, which is reckoned to him when he believes. There were radically different views on salvation. They could not be reconciled. One of them was the gospel. One of them was not. Thus, what was at stake in the Reformation was the gospel of Jesus Christ. And although the Council of Trent made many fine affirmations of traditional truths of the Christian faith, it declared justification by faith alone to be an anathema, ignoring many plain teachings of Scripture, such as Romans 3:28, where we hold that one is justified by faith apart from works of the law. Now, many Christians, churches, and organizations regularly use the word gospel to describe their convictions. Theological controversies have occurred and do occur over the meaning of the gospel and who preaches it faithfully. What does that familiar word gospel mean? The best way to answer that question is to turn to the authoritative word of God. Now, in the New Testament, the noun evangelion, or gospel, it appears over 70 times. And since in one sense, the whole New Testament is about the gospel, we might have expected the word to have been used more frequently. Even worse, its uses vary greatly among the authors of the New Testament books. Paul uses the word more than three times as often as all the other authors combined. Most of the other uses are found in Matthew and Mark, with very few, if any, in Luke, John, Peter, and James. The word gospel most simply means good news. The word is not unique to the Christian message, but it was also used in the pagan world to refer to a good announcement. In the New Testament, it refers to the good news of Jesus the Savior and Lord. Often it is used with the assumption that the reader knows what it means. And as we look more closely at the ways in which the gospel is used in the New Testament, several points come through very clearly. First, we often find the phrase, the gospel of God. This phrase stresses the source of the gospel as a gift of God. The gospel is of divine, not human origin. Second, the character of the gospel is specified in several ways. The gospel is true in Galatians 2:5 and Galatians 2:14 and Colossians 1:5, gracious in Acts 20:20. And glorious in 2 Corinthians 4:4 and 1 Timothy 1:11. Third, we see two responses of the gospel. The primary response is faith in Acts 15:7 and Ephesians 1:13. But obedience is also a response in 1 Peter 4:7 and Romans 1:5 and Romans 10:16 and Romans 16:26 and 2 Thessalonians 1:8. Paul's use of the idea of the obedience of faith in Romans has an element of irony as a response to those who have accused him of antinomianism, that is, being against the law. Fourth, we see several truths of the gospel. The gospel, of course, brings salvation according to Romans 1:16 and Ephesians 1:13. It also brings the kingdom in Matthew 4:23, Matthew 9:35, and Matthew 24:14. The gospel evokes hope in the people of God, as in Colossians 1:23. The gospel is also a motivation to sanctification in Mark 8:35, Mark 10:29, 2 Corinthians 9:13, Ephesians 6:15, and Philippians 1:27. All these ways in which the word gospel is used point to its content, but there are also passages in the New Testament that are explicit as to its content. And in fact, in examining these texts, we discover that sometimes the word gospel refers broadly to all aspects of the salvation and the new life that Jesus gives to his people. And sometimes it's used narrowly to refer to what Jesus does for us outside of us. In other words, sometimes the word gospel refers broadly to Jesus' work of justification and sanctification for and in his people. And sometimes it refers narrowly to Jesus' work of justification. Another way of putting this distinction is that sometimes the word gospel refers broadly to all the New Testament fulfillment of what was promised in the Old Testament. And sometimes the term gospel is used narrowly of Jesus' doing in contrast to our doing of the law. An example of the broader sense of the gospel can be seen in Mark 1:11, the beginning of the gospel of Jesus, the Son of God. This use of the word gospel seems to refer to everything that Mark tells us about the teaching and work of Jesus Christ alone. We see another broad use of this in Revelation 14:6-7, which says this: "Then I saw another angel flying directly overhead with an eternal gospel to proclaim to those who dwell on the earth, to every nation and tribe and language and people. And he said with a loud voice, 'Fear God and give him glory, because the hour of his judgment has come. And worship him who made heaven and earth, the sea and the springs of the water.'" Here, the gospel is the call to repent and worship God. More often, the term gospel is used narrowly, and its content is specified. We see this in 1 Corinthians 15:1-4, which says, "Now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures." Here, the gospel is the message of the saving death and resurrection of Jesus Christ alone. The source of the gospel is a gift of God. The gospel is of divine, not human origin. In another place, Paul writes of the glorious gospel, the blessed God, of with which I have been entrusted. And he specifies what the gospel is in 1 Timothy 1:11 and 1 Timothy 1:15-16, when he says, "The saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the foremost. But I received mercy for this reason, that in me, as the foremost, Jesus Christ might display his perfect patience as an example to those who were to believe in him for eternal life." Here, the gospel is a saving work of Christ for sinners. Paul writes similarly in 2 Timothy 1:8-10 and 2 Timothy 2:8, saying, "Therefore, do not be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord, nor of me as prisoner, but share in suffering for the gospel by the power of God, who saved us and called us to a holy calling, not because of our works, but because of his own purpose and grace, which he gave us in Christ Jesus before the ages began, and which now has been manifested through the appearing of our Savior, Christ Jesus, who abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. Remember Jesus Christ, risen from the dead, the offspring of David, as preached in my gospel." Now, this narrow use of the word gospel was very common in the writings of the 16th century reformers. We can see it in the thought of John Calvin, who said this: "The word of faith is put by metonymy, using the name of one concept for another concept to which it is related. For the word of promise, i.e. the gospel itself, since it is related to faith, the contrast between law and gospel is to be understood. And from this distinction, we deduce that just as a law demands work, the gospel requires only that men should bring faith in order to receive the grace of God." It is also clear in Zacchaeus Euricinus. Near the beginning of his commentary on the Heidelberg Catechism, Euricinus divides all of doctrine into law and gospel, saying, "The doctrine of the church consists in two parts, the law and the gospel, in which we have comprehended the sum and the substance of the sacred scripture. The law is called the Decalogue, and the gospel is the doctrine concerning Christ the mediator and the free remission of sins through faith," he says. Such reflections on the gospel have remained common in Reformed theology, as we see from this long but fascinating quotation from the great Dutch theologian Herman Bavinck, who said this: "But the word of God, both as law and gospel, is a revelation of the will of God, the promulgation of the covenant of works and the covenant of grace. Although in a broad sense, the term law and gospel can indeed be used to denote the old and the new dispensation of the covenant of grace, in their actual significance, they define and describe two essential different revelations of divine will." Bavinck here cites many New Testament proof texts. In these texts, law and gospel are contrasted as demand and gift, as command and promise, as sin and grace, as sickness and healing, as death and life. The law proceeds from God's holiness, the gospel from God's grace. The law is known from nature, the gospel only from special revelation. The law demands perfect righteousness, but the gospel grants it. The law leads people to eternal life by works, and the gospel produces good works from the riches of the eternal life granted in faith. The law presently condemns people, and the gospel acquits them. The law addresses itself to all people, and the gospel only to those who live within its hearing. How clear, distinct, biblical, and precious is this presentation of the gospel. Now, the church needs to preach the gospel in both its broad and narrow senses. The Greek word for gospel has given the English-speaking word the word evangelism. True evangelism, according to the Great Commission given by Jesus in Matthew 28:18-20, is a matter of making disciples, first, in the narrow sense of calling men and women to believe in Jesus, and second, in the broad sense of teaching them to observe all the things that Jesus has taught his people. For the sake of the gospel, let's all promote true evangelism. Now, the Reformation in the 16th century is long known as a religious renewal movement, which we refer to today as the Protestant Reformation. This movement is known to have changed the course of Western civilization. But what is often not understood about this event is that no single man caused it. For example, it didn't begin with Martin Luther, who lived from 1483 to 1546, when he posted his 95 theses on the church doors of that Wittenberg church on October 31st, 1517. Luther's tower experience is said to be where he came to grasp the definitive doctrine of the Reformation, justification by faith alone. And it's also important to note that the Reformation grew out of earlier attempts for renewal, the most notable of which was led by Peter Waldo in 1140 to 1217 AD, and his followers in the Alpine regions, i.e. John Wycliffe, who lived from 1324 to 1384. Along with these two men, the Lollards in England, those without an academic background, and John Huss, and his followers in Bohemia, are also significant figures in the Reformation. All these men and many more are called forerunners of the Reformation rather than reformers, since although they anticipated many of the emphasis of the Reformation, they lacked a complete understanding of the critical doctrine of justification by faith alone. While the intent of Luther's Reformation was originally to purge the Roman Catholic Church of its abuses, the Lord expanded this Reformation's reach and influence into other regions and throughout the whole world in the coming centuries. And its five core teachings are as valuable today as they were in the 16th century. The Reformers taught what is known as the five solas: Scripture alone, or sola scriptura; faith alone, sola fide; grace alone, sola gratias; Christ alone, solus Christus; and to the glory of God alone, sola Deo gloria. Dr. Joel Beakey says the first of these battle cries deal with the fundamental issue of authority, the middle three deal with the basics of salvation, and the final one addresses worship. In the past few years, researchers have been hard at work studying problems in the American church. One study done by sociologist Christopher Smith and his fellow researchers with the National Study of Youth and Religion came to conclude that American youth, what they believe, I mean, is in a philosophy called moral therapeutic deism. Smith and his research team defined this in the following ways. First, a God exists who created and ordered the world and watches over human life. Second, God wants people to be good, nice, and fair to each other, as taught in the Bible and by most world religions. Third, the central goal of life is to be happy and to feel good about oneself. Fourth, God does not need to be particularly involved in one's life except when God is needed to resolve a problem. Lastly, good people go to heaven when they die. While this definition is significant for many reasons, the decline of mainstream American denominations came about as a denial of the authority of the Word of God. And when the authority of the Bible is diminished, there is no standard for faith and practice. Thus, a return to the first sola, sola scriptura, should be our battle cry. The scriptures are the inspired, inerrant, authoritative, and sufficient word of God. So when the Bible speaks, God's people should hear, heed, and obey the word by his grace through the ministry of the Spirit. Not only this, the Bible proclaims the truth of the other solas, namely that salvation is by grace alone, through faith alone, and Christ alone. Man has not been saved for his own purposes, but for God's glory and purposes. Thus, man's greatest need is indeed Christ. As Charles Spurgeon said, "I have a great need of Christ, and I have a great Christ for my need." The greatest need of the church has always been for reformation around the Word of God. And so undergirding these five solas is Ecclesia Semper Reformanda Est, which means the church is always to be reformed. The Word of God stands over us individually and collectively. This is why the church must always be a listening church. Romans 10:17 says, "Faith comes by hearing, and hearing through the Word of Christ." So rather than being restrictive, Ecclesia Semper Reformanda Est, it undergirds the five solas by providing a foundation upon which they can stand. See, the five solas provide the foundation for a robust and evangelical faith and practice. As we know, and as we talk about on this show, there are many false teachers who have gone out into the world, and we know from Revelation 9 where they emanate from the pit of hell. So today we need reformation. We need to stand on the word of God. We need to preach the whole word of God, and we need to proclaim the whole word of God in both our evangelism to non-Christians and in our discipleship with other Christians. That means that I need you and you need me, but supremely we need the Lord Jesus. We need to be crystal clear today that we must proclaim the word of God. The word of God, as I've often said, is its own best apologetic, i.e. it is its own best defense. And Luther once compared the word of God to a lion. We don't just make things up. We unleash, as Spurgeon once remarked, we unleash the word when we're engaging in apologetics, when we're engaging in evangelism or discipleship or any other ministry. We're just opening its pages, and the word of God is ministering and speaking and helping us to rightly minister the word. And this is why we need to understand the importance of hermeneutics. Everybody is coming to the word of God. The question is, what are you doing with the word of God? Because what you do with the word of God reveals what you believe about the word. So we must be careful, not only what we believe about the word of God itself is from the word, but we must have the right foundations that are rooted in scripture and in the good theology of the church. So this is why we need reformation today, and it's not only about the Catholic Church. We need reformation around the Word of God in the church today, because we have the growing movement of the New Apostolic Reformation. We have the growing movement of deliverance ministry. We have the growing movement of social justice. We have the growing movement of transgenderism, and all of these movements are claiming in some way or some part to be biblical, to be rooted in the scripture. So we must be clear that these movements are actually oppose the knowledge of God, because behind them, they don't believe the word of God. And that is why they don't have a right hermeneutic in the first place. Well, I want to thank you for listening or watching this episode of Contending for the Word. It's such a joy to see how the Lord is continuing to use this podcast. I'm really excited about who's going to be coming on in the coming months, and I hope you are too, as we continue to talk about these things and intersperse throughout the next couple of months. I won't be doing as many episodes just by myself, just so you guys know. I know three is a lot, but we have a lot of great guests upcoming, and even more in the coming years. So I just want to thank you for listening or watching and this show, and please tell your friends about Contending for the Word. Until next week, may God bless you and keep you.
Thank you for listening to this episode of Contending for the Word. If you enjoyed this episode, please subscribe to the show and rate us wherever you listen to podcasts. Be sure to also like, subscribe, and follow Servants of Grace on Facebook, Instagram, or X. We appreciate your support.